Okay. Hello everyone, welcome to the ISCB Student Council webinars. Before we start, I would like to let you know that we have currently an open call for abstract submissions for the next round of webinars. You can find the information in Twitter at ISCB SC. I'm sorry. Now I would like to present to you Rodrigo Ochoa from University of Antioquia. We'll talk about his work studying peptides binding to MHC class 2.
Okay, thank you very much for the ISCB for the opportunity to share my work. And today I'm going to present part of my PhD project related with the ranking of peptides bound to the MHC class 2 using structure and dynamic based methodologies, explicitly using molecular dynamics and scoring functions. So I am part of a Max Planck tandem group that was created in Colombia. And the project is directed by Pilar Cosio from the University of Antioquia, from Dr. Pilar Cosio, and Dr. Alessandro Laio from the International School of Advanced Studies, CISA, in Trieste, Italy. So first, just to mention something about my group. So I am part of this university in Medellin, Colombia. This is one of the oldest public universities in my country. And I am part of this group focused on biophysics of tropical diseases. And specifically, I've been working a lot in bioinformatics and computational biophysics to discover and design therapeutic alternatives for neglected tropical diseases, including drugs, drug discovery, vaccine, among other methodologies. So the motivation of this work is the computational design of peptides, specifically using structure-based methodologies, where we take into account proteins as molecular targets. So for that analysis, first we have to check how to explore efficiently the sequence space of the peptides in order to filter or to select the best candidates. Then if we have structural information, the idea is to check the best way to explore the conformational space. And after having a complex structure, the idea is to check the methodologies to estimate the binding between the peptide and the protein. So for that purpose, there are different methodologies, template-based approaches, de novo approaches. There are some successful examples in the literature. However, there is still required optimization of the methods in order to have a better balance between accuracy and computational effectiveness. That is basically what we require in a design protocol.
Rodrigo, the slides are not changing.
Are not changing? Okay, yeah. Let me put again in presentation. Let me know if they are changing now. Are they?
No.
Not yet?
Now I saw a change.
Let me try again. I'm going to put in presentation again.
Okay.
Is showing or not?
I am seeing slide number 3.
Yeah, and I am doing some animations too.
No.
No, but you can see the full slide or not?
Yeah, I mean we see the sidebar is not in presentation mode.
Okay. Okay. So I'm going to stop the screen and try again. Okay.
Okay.
Okay, I think you can see now, maybe. Can you see the presentation?
Yes.
Now you can see.
Yeah, now it's okay. Thank you.
Okay, no problem. So just to sum up again a little bit, just to mention about the group I'm working, the Max Planck-Tandon Group of Biophysics of Tropical Diseases. And I was mentioning the motivation of this work related with the computational peptide design, how to explore the sequence space, how to explore the conformations, how to estimate the binding, and that there are different methodologies, but at the end, the idea is to optimize the protocols to have a better balance between accuracy and computational effectiveness. So in the application fields that I was mentioning, many of the peptides, right now peptides have been studied a lot for drug discovery purposes, doing, for example, modifications of the peptides as peptide mimetics or other kind of modifications. In immunology, there is also a big impact, for example, in vaccine development, the discovery of B and T cell epitopes, and also in proteomics and for the study of protein-protein interaction, the discovery of biomarkers, among other things. So right now, for this presentation, I'm focused on this system, the MHC class 2, that is actually very related with the vaccine design and also immunological therapies. So the project is part of a big protocol that we are working on for designing new peptides. But in this case, the method is applied to the system, the MHC class 2. And the main goal is try to look for methodologies to do an efficient sample of the system, in this case using molecular dynamics, and also try to score potential modifications or new sequences based on scoring functions that are normally used in molecular docking. But the idea is try to implement them, for example, in consensus to see if we are able to rank between peptides based on the predicted affinity. So in fact, we published this work last year in the Journal of Chemical Information Modeling. So in case someone wants to get increased information about that, yeah, you can check this publication. But I'm going to put some context about it. So the MHC class 2, as the MHC class 1, are related with the with triggering immunological response. So in the case of MHC class 2, normally this process occurs in the late endosome, where the proteolysed proteins fragments interact with the MHC class 2. But there are other molecular partners, proteins that are included in the system, in the process, sorry, to allow this interaction. But for this, for our project, we are completely focused on the bound conformation of the peptides to this MHC class 2 and try to rank between peptide binders. So this is relevant because in a way is a one important step to trigger immunological response. It's not the only one. And there are different sequence-based methodologies, but the idea is try to include this structural information because we can have additional data to play with and try to improve the predictions. And actually is a proof of concept of the design protocol we are working on. So this is a picture of the structure of the MHC class 2. It is composed of four subunits, and two of them are they responsible to create a binding group where a peptide binds. And this peptide in particular has a main core region that is highlighted in green here. That is called the core region because it's quite responsible of the interaction with the MHC class 2. However, the peptides could be longer, for example, around 13, 15, or 20 amino acids in order to increase, in some cases, affinity and stability. But from a predictive perspective, it's very challenging because we have different sizes and this could affect, in this case, the prediction because we need a lot of training data for that. This is another view of the protein structure. As you can see in purple, you can find some key amino acids that interact with four pockets in the protein that we call P1, P4, P6, and P9. This interaction has been reported as crucial for the binding between the peptide and the MHC and the MHC class II. And because of that, the chemical nature of the amino acids are crucial to increase the affinity, not only with the MHC, but also with a third partner, that is the T cell receptors, after the MHC is in the surface of the cell. But for our case, we are only focused on the direct interaction between MHC class II and the peptide. So here the question is how to implement the scoring functions in order to correlate the results with experimental data to rank the peptides. So the strategy in this case was to start from a crystallized peptide and try to model new sequences through iterative single mutations. So one thing about the bound conformation of the peptide is that it's quite conserved for this MHC class II, and actually it has a particular secondary structure that we can take advantage to do the modeling of the new peptide. And the validation of the methodology is using Spearman correlations that are used to evaluate the ranking of the sequences in agreement with the data. The thing is, we can try to do, for example, numerical correlation, but in general, it's very difficult to do. But at least if we are able to rank the peptides in order of affinity, it could be useful for the methodology we are working on. So to do that, we had to look for a data set, a reliable data set. So we selected this this public data set that is used on the IEDB, the Immune Epitope Database. This is a publication from 2010. And this publication contains around 26 MHC class II alleles with 44,000 affinities that is very useful, for example, to create predictive models. However, we look for a crystal structure containing bioactivity data in this dataset. So we found this particular structure with a 15 amino acid peptide with an IC50 value reported. So the idea is to start from this crystal with the protein peptide conformation and then try to mutate amino acid by amino acid at each position of the peptide. So after doing the mutation, normally we sample each mutation through optimization of the side chains with the backbone fix. We use Rosetta for doing that. And then we apply or we use a molecular dynamic simulation of the system. So we normally protonate the system at a pH of 5.3, that is the normal pH of the endosome. And we subjected the complex to 100 nanoseconds at 350K temperature. So the idea is to increase the conformational exploration in the minimum energy we are located, but to guarantee that the system will not collapse because of that, we restrain atoms away from the interaction site, just in order to see how is the flexibility in the binding site between the peptide and the pockets. So this is a view of the molecular dynamics. The part that is bound directly to the core region is quite stable. The flanking amino acids are normally very flexible, but this interaction can be stabilized by other partners like the T cells. However, what we did is we obtained different snapshots from the trajectory, and we just focus on the last quarter, just after checking that the system in a way is converged. And we obtain an average score doing scoring each snapshot and then calculating an average. And for that purpose, we use 18 different scoring functions. These functions are open source, are available for protein-protein and protein-peptide interactions. And these functions include Rosetta, Haddock, and other methodologies. So for doing this analysis, we selected an initial set of 8 peptides. The basis to select this peptide was based on IC50 values with big difference between them in order to have discriminative power of the model. We also predicted with 2 different methodologies the core regions of these peptides, because based on these core regions, we can perform the single point mutation that I mentioned before. And also we took into account if there are identical amino acids in the core region, because in that way, we don't have to model the entire peptide, and at least we can trust from some conformations of the initial crystal structure. So this is important for the modeling too. This is a view of the model peptides. As you can see, this linear conformation, despite this linear, is quite stable. This is a view of the pockets and the interaction of the side chains with the pockets. And also you can see in the left the alignments of these epitopes and the key position that I mentioned before that are going to be crucial to do the single mutation. So after doing the modeling, after running the molecular dynamics, you can see in this plot the correlation between the scores and experimental data. So basically, in the left of each plot, you can find the peptides with the highest affinity. And in the right of the plot, you can find the peptides with the lowest affinity. And you can see this picture for 4 of the 18 scoring functions. So you can see, for example, the first one in the figure in the A section is quite good doing the correlation. But as you can see, the peptides are represented by colors, but you not only see one value per peptide, you can see 4 of them. Because the idea is that if we're having this long molecular dynamics, the idea is to see that the score is converged as well, at least, or try to see what are the fluctuations of the score in this last part of the system. So we apply a block analysis where we divided our final part in 4 equidistant blocks, and we calculated an average per block. So with this, what we try to do is not only calculate one correlation, but in this case, try to calculate a random number of correlations. So in this case, we applied a bootstrapping approach where we calculated the correlation 2,000 times using randomly any of the scores per block. So in that sense, we obtain a distribution of the Spearman correlation. So in this figure, you can see the cumulative probability of this distribution. And the idea is to select the scoring functions with cumulative probabilities located in the right part of the plot. So with the highest average Spearman correlation above 0.5, for example. So based on that, we selected 6 of these scoring functions, including BINA, that is normally used for small molecules, but works pretty well for these peptides. And with these 6 of them, we obtain this average correlation above 0.5. So the second question was, okay, can we just try to use just one of them, or can we try to use a consensus approach where we can take into account the prediction of each of them? Because as you know, scoring functions are mathematical expressions that try to simplify the calculation of binding, but because of that, there are many approximations that maybe one scoring function doesn't take into account. So the idea is try to include as much as possible in a consensus way. So for doing that, we apply the following. This is an example. For example, if I have n number of peptides, and I have a delta G value between each pair of peptides. So I have the binding difference between peptide 1 and 2, 1 and 3, 1 and n, and so on. So the idea is that we can check by pairs of peptides if the difference between the scores are in agreement with the difference in the experimental information. So for a comparison, we just focus on the sign of the differences. So just in order to rank the affinities, are in this case the experimental difference. So for that, we apply this consensus methodology that is basically a consensus by vote, where we are going to have 6 votes in this case because of the 6 scoring functions. And this vote is going to be 1 if the sign of the score difference is equal to the sign of the delta G, and 0 otherwise. So the consensus will be in agreement with the experimental if the sum of these votes is greater than a defined threshold that I am going to explain later. And this consensus was also evaluated using two additional models. So we applied a linear regression model, not to relate the numerical delta delta G, but to try to predict the sign of the numerical delta delta G, and a logistic regression model with a binary response. So for doing for testing these models, we applied a cross-validation strategy, where we applied a Lee-one-out-like strategy. Basically here, what we did is, for example, from the initial set of peptides, we remove one at a time, and with the remaining peptides, we create a training set with all the peptide pairs possible. And with the peptide we remove, we create the test set with all the pairs possible. So we did that, the model and validation, n times, in this case, 8 times, because it's the number of peptides we selected. And we also run the consensus threshold, as mentioned before, and also predict this agreement between the scores and the experimental data using each scoring function alone. So these are the final tables with the summaries of the prediction. As you can see, each row means the peptide that was used for the testing. And you can see an accuracy value of the model prediction per each peptide per each scoring function. So some of them, for example, the S5 had an average prediction of 80%, an accuracy of 80% of all the possible pairs. And we applying the consensus strategy. We use the consensus by threshold, as I mentioned, with two different thresholds, 3 and 4. It means that if 3 or 4 or more scoring functions are in agreement with the sign of the score and the experimental data, we count that like a match or a mismatch otherwise. And we have also the prediction of the linear model and the logistic regression model. So in general, we found that with the logistic regression model, we obtained the better results. And also we have the possibility to see the weights that are assigned to each scoring function to see which is more responsible to to improve the correlation between the scoring and the experimental data. So in general, the methodology was quite good for the system we applied. It means that we can use this system for other peptides. Actually, we have a protocol to automatize this modeling of peptides, and we've been applying it with successful results. Obviously, it's not perfect, but at least from a structural perspective, can allow us to try to include modifications on these peptides for a design purpose. So in general, just to summarize, something important is try to configure the molecular dynamic simulation. So in this case, we apply this high temperature with restraints on some backbone atoms. That was very useful to explore the flexibility of the complex, assuming the minimum energetic we are starting, that is based on this crystal bound conformation. And the consensus of this 6 scoring function report average spin-on correlation above 0.7. So in general, it's a nice strategy that we can use to, for example, try to perform single mutations on the peptide and try to see if this mutation can improve or not the binding affinity, for example, to design adjuvants in a vaccine or something similar. So just to finalize, I want to mention the research team involved. I want to thank Dr. Alessandro Lyon, Dr. Miguel Soler from the CISA Institute that have been working a lot in this in the designing of these peptides, to Dr. Pilar Cosio, that is the director of the Max Antonio Group, to some collaborators, including Dr. Robinson Ramirez from the University of Antioquia, that have supported us in the immunological part, and Dr. Janet Thornton and Dr. Roman Laskowski from the European Bioinformatics Institute, that have helped us a lot with the bioinformatics part of the project. So that's all. Thank you very much. And any question, I will be happy to answer. Hi, I don't know, Catalina, have you see?
We can wait a bit because the presentation can be delayed.
Okay.
So we can wait for a few minutes for questions.
Okay. Sorry about the beginning. I didn't okay. notice that the presentation wasn't showing the screen.
It's okay. So while we wait for questions, I want to remind everyone that we have open calls for abstract for the next round of seminars that will be from July until the end of the year. You can go to Twitter at ISCBSC to get more information on that.
So I think that's it.
Yeah, I think there are no questions.
Yeah, but it's fine. No, thank you. And yeah, if maybe some of the people who can watch this have any question or want to discuss about the project, just let me know. I have the contact. Ah, okay.
So there is one question.
That is fair to compare these rankings with other in silico approaches. Yes, I mean, the thing is, the thing with MHC class two, as you maybe know, that, yeah, we have done some comparison, but the thing is, we are trying to use peptides that are not included in the training sets of these methodologies. So right now, what we are doing is that we are performing the experimental validation of some of these peptides, some new peptides, completely new peptides. And we have the ranking with the machine learning, and we have this evaluation. And the idea is, after having the experimental data, we can check how can we complement. Because the idea is not to replace; it is to complement the sequence-based strategy to try to improve the prediction. And the other question is what is important in this interaction? I mean, there are many key factors in this interaction that are related with immunological response. So, for example, these MHC class II receptors are quite promiscuous, so they can bind different kind of peptides. Sometimes this interaction could have a better or lower affinity depending on the role of the epitope. But at least trying to understand that the presence of certain side chains can allow or can imply that the peptide is going to be a better binder or not, can allow us to understand a little bit what is the mechanistic behind the interaction with these epitopes. So one of the goals that many people do when they are trying to work with vaccine is try to look for the peptide with the highest affinities, but in some cases probably we can look for the other way around. So if at least from a structural perspective, we can control which amino acid to model and how to, in a more or less reliable way, to predict this affinity will be useful for a mechanistic study of this interaction. I think, I hope this is clear for the questions you did. And if anybody is interested, I will be in contact. I mean, in the presentation, I think I put at the end some information, so I will be available.
Thank you, Rodrigo, and thank you everyone who connected to the live stream.
Okay, thank you.